So after Cenk's nephew uploaded the entire video of him criticizing me, I noticed there was an entire section that I missed, and that was him talking about one of my healthcare videos. And I kind of have to go back and review this because healthcare is one of the first things that I researched when I got into politics, and I got really good at it. I've debated congressional candidates on healthcare before, and I have a lot of research and resources on it, so let's just jump right into it.
How to fix healthcare.
Are so expensive, and what should we do about it? The main reason is a lack of competition. We have very few doctors, much less doctors than we actually need.
Okay, I mean, based. Let's make med school free. I'm on board with that. Let's make med school free, I think. That's a good way to do that. Free med school, free college in general.
One of the reasons for this is the American Medical Association works on limiting the amount of medical schools and the graduates for those medical schools.
Dude, what? Yo, I love the American Enterprise Institute, dude. My man's like, you know what we need to do? We need more chiropractors with MDs, okay? That's what we need to do. Lower the restriction on who can be a doctor. So what about all these other countries where there are more doctors per capita than the United States?
So I actually wasn't expecting this section to be more bad faith than the worker cooperative section, but here we are. You see, I didn't say anything about deregulation. I didn't say anything about reducing the qualifications for doctors. I merely pointed out that the number of medical schools and the number of doctors are restricted through various government cronyist policies. Cenk's nephew does not even try to contest this. He merely forms a straw man and attacks that. He points out that some other countries have more doctors per capita. But this does not refute my point. I am explaining why the US has a shortage of doctors. And essentially his only response is, yes, the US does have a shortage of doctors. Thank you, Cenk's nephew, for contributing absolutely nothing.
Do they have less restrictive processes on who gets to become a doctor? Is that how that works? It's the unions, dude? That's why? What about the NHS? What about all of the fucking European countries?
Okay, yes. Let's talk about the European countries. Licensure requirements in the United States cover a much broader swath of the healthcare workforce than in Europe. And in Europe, the lowest licensure rates are found in Nordic countries like Sweden, Norway, and Denmark. The percentage of licensed workers in health practitioners and technical in the US is 42.6%. In Nordic countries, it's 45.2%. In healthcare support, the US is 46.5%. In Nordic countries, it's 27.4%. Looking at the total labor force of healthcare workers, in the US, it's slightly below the European average, but in Nordic countries, it's 15.3%. In the US, as opposed to its European peers, there is a much broader range of healthcare workers who are subject to licensure. Denmark has the lowest overall rate of occupational licensure in Europe. In the UK, healthcare assistants and physician assistants are unlicensed, while in the US, licenses are required. In these other countries, when they do have licenses, they are usually national licenses. In the US, the right to provide health services is determined on a state-by-state basis. This can make the process of being licensed much more expensive, somewhere between $35 to $1,400 per state. Whereas in France, you get a national license for $371. In the United Kingdom, a national license for $506. In Denmark, basic authorization is $0, and it's $175 for independent practices. In Sweden, it is $287. And of course, the licenses in Denmark and Sweden do not expire. Various fees in the US amount to tens of thousands of dollars. The European countries don't have these issues. In the US, over 22% of physicians are licensed in at least two states, and 7% have licenses in three or more states. If you were to be licensed in every state, it would cost well over $10,000 in renewal fees every couple of years. There's only 14 doctors in the entire country that are licensed in all 50 states. There was a report from the OECD that analyzed the impact of occupational licensure across industries in the United States. They found harmful effects along a number of dimensions. The study accounted for both the pervasiveness of licensing and the heterogeneity across states and occupation. Licensure was associated with fewer transitions out of joblessness, especially for those with a criminal record, as well as job switching between employers. The barriers that licensing creates on reemployment are especially a problem. Unlike in most European countries, US states often license even entry-level occupations, such as nursing assistants. Healthcare licensing in the US is more pervasive, burdensome, and harmful than anywhere else. Nordic countries like Sweden and Denmark are a great benchmark for reforming licensing regulations. In the US, we should license professions more selectively and attempt to streamline the processes as much as possible. So in summary, the answer to Cenk's nephew's question...
Where there are more doctors per capita, for example. What's going on? Is it because they deregulated?
Yes, this is because they have less regulation in certain areas. This is not a hard concept to grasp. A country can have more regulation in certain areas and then have less regulation in different areas. And as for doctors per capita, that is a metric we can look at, but I don't care about that as much as actual doctor shortages. Doctors per capita doesn't accurately reflect on the amount of doctors you actually need. From one year to the next, you can maintain the exact number of doctors per capita, but then have a doctor shortage, because the demand for doctors can change within that one year, even if the supply stays the same. Cenk's nephew specifically mentioned the NHS, and recently the NHS encountered a doctor shortage of almost 50,000 doctors.
Another way in which competition is destroyed is certificate of need laws. With these laws, you have to provide proof to your federal or state government that your hospital or hospital equipment is needed. For example, if I want to add 200 more beds to my hospital, I have to prove that I need those 200 beds instead of just being able to freely buy them. Or if I want to build a new hospital, a second hospital in an area so it can compete and have competitive prices, I have to prove it's actually needed. Now, one hospital may provide for the needs of the community, but then they can just end up having a monopoly in that community and charge high prices. But if someone is able to build a second hospital, then they can compete.
We need to deregulate hospitals is like not the, I mean, this is your brain on libertarianism. This dude is actually one step removed from talking about the baby marketplace, okay? Yeah, guys, instead of having a monopoly in one individual area with hospitals, we need to have a duopoly, okay? That would be so much better.
Right, so leftists like Hassan sit in their multi-million dollar houses, and when presented with things that could actually help regular people afford healthcare, he laughs it off because he has no clue what he's talking about. And he only cares about attention rather than actual policies. Now here, I never made any claims about substantial deregulation. Now I do want substantial deregulation, but again, that's not what I argued for in my video. I argued against certificate of need laws. Why would he be against getting rid of certificate of need laws? Why is he protecting monopolies? This guy is an establishment shill. Certificate of need laws reduce the number of beds in the typical hospital by 12%. And the number of hospitals per 1,000 persons by 48%. This leads to urban hospital CEOs extracting economic rents of $91,000 annually. Why is he not against this, exactly? The only reason he's against this is because I said it, right? He doesn't care about helping anybody. He doesn't care about laws that genuinely hurt people. He only cares about being an influencer e-boy. Is a duopoly better than a monopoly? Yes. I mean, why wouldn't it be? If we had an option between the two, why would we not choose duopoly? But that's not even a dichotomy. You can have private practices and you can have more than two hospitals. You can have more than two options. But right now, millions of people are affected by these certificate of need laws. Millions of people have to pay more money because of these certificate of need laws. And they might even potentially lead to deaths. I mean, when you have a shortage of hospital beds and you have pandemics like COVID, that's a real issue. But Cenk's nephew does not care about solving real issues. If he did, then he would actually fully support that TikTok that I put up. He should agree with literally everything I said. Nothing I said contradicts a leftist position. Like, obviously, they want to nationalize healthcare, but that's not happening anytime soon. In the meantime, they should support getting rid of these harmful policies. He could have sat there in front of his hundreds of thousands of followers and said, yes, let's get rid of certificate of need laws. And he could have gotten people actively talking about this and actively realizing what's going on and being against monopoly protections. But he didn't do that. He chose to take the side of corruption and monopolies. Now, as for his brief remark on baby markets, he clearly doesn't understand the libertarian position on this. There is currently a baby market, as in there's a demand for babies and there is a supply, because, you know, some people have babies and they're not able to keep them or they don't want to keep them. So that's where adoption comes in. Adoption agencies are middlemen who make tens of thousands of dollars through adoptions. The libertarian argument is just that the parents, or specifically the woman who went through the process of giving birth, should be entitled to some of that compensation. I mean, she did have to go through a very long and painful process. It's one of the most painful things that the average human being can endure. So I'm not totally sure why Cenk's nephew is against compensation for women who have to endure this. It's just odd, right? The baby market is a funny name. It's not about selling babies for slavery. It's just about adding parental compensation in the process of adoption instead of a middleman getting all of the money.
What we need to do is build hospitals with no regulation. Like, why would the hospitals cut prices, dude? More supply would mean that the prices would be cut. Why would they do that? They have no incentive to do that. They will never do that. There is inelastic demand, brother. You know, you clearly took the Econ 101 course. You know, micro and macroeconomic principles. You took both of those courses probably, or at least you're acting like you did.
I think probably the best case against free speech is when leftists talk about inelastic demand. They have no clue what inelastic demand is. When a demand is priced inelastic, this essentially just means that when prices changed, a consumer's buying habits change much less than usual. Take gasoline, for example. People still need to drive around, they need to go to work, they need to go to the store. So recently, when we saw huge hikes in gasoline prices, people were still purchasing gasoline. Now, of course, some people found ways to get around this as much as possible. Because of these higher prices, maybe they took a little bit more of public transportation or rode their bikes, whatever. But for the most part, buying habits didn't really change. However, even though prices were generally going up, and the demand for gasoline is price inelastic, people are still generally going to try to go to the cheapest gas station in the area. There is still price competition. So in healthcare, if you have the option to go to another hospital, to go to another doctor, another practice, then you are going to do this, at least as long as that other option has better quality or lower prices. So yes, there is incentives there. And this whole fantasy that leftists paint of inelastic healthcare has never historically or empirically manifested. Not in the sense that it's not inelastic, but it's just not in the way that they describe it. For example, today we have the healthcare crisis, and this is that healthcare is very expensive. But 80 years ago, the healthcare crisis was that medical costs were too low, and health insurance was way too accessible. This was just a crisis to the doctors who wanted to make more. That's what led to the American Medical Association restricting doctors and going heavily into occupational licensing, like I explained earlier. So back then in America and other countries, you had fraternal societies. Over a quarter of all adult Americans were members of fraternal societies. A group of working class people would form an association and pay monthly fees into the association's treasury. Individual members would then be able to draw from the pool in times of need. Groups would contract doctors to provide medical care to their members. If the doctor provided subpar medical services, then the group would get rid of them. So there was competition to achieve these contracts. So doctors had competitive pricing. It didn't matter that healthcare is price inelastic. If Cenk's nephew and leftists were correct about price inelasticity in healthcare, then we would have not seen this historical example. We also wouldn't see today that certificate of need laws lead to increases in spending. Specifically, an average of 3.1% in total spending, 13.1% higher spending by patients in less than good health, healthcare prices on average 13.8% higher in certificate of need states, and Medicaid spends 60% more per nursing home enrollee in certificate of need states.
There's been many studies on certificate of need laws that show very bad effects. We do not need these. We need to get rid of these.
How about, looking at any number of studies conducted on this matter, not from the point of view of like deregulation, but actually from the point of view of socialization, okay? It's like impossible to look at this subject and not find a single fucking study that shows that socializing healthcare or nationalizing healthcare yields better results. How did you avoid all of that and go straight to the American Enterprise Institute that's about like a very weird random way to just like fucking lower healthcare prices by like 10 cents? I really don't understand how good for him. He must have searched hard, long and hard for this.
What I'm getting from this is all you need to do to be a leftist Twitch streamer is that whenever someone makes a point, simply laugh at them and claim, well, there is some studies that agree with me. Okay, could you please cite any of these? What are these magical studies that are floating around somewhere? How am I even supposed to respond to something like this? I'm almost convinced that the purpose of saying these vague things is to cripple anyone trying to make a direct response. But anyways, supporting the nationalization of healthcare, whilst also being against monopolization of healthcare, is a contradiction. Nationalization is in fact monopolization. Setting up further government intrusion into your health doesn't seem like a very good idea. More bureaucracy, more red tape. I can't possibly see how any reasonable person would support this, especially when seeing the historical examples of the fraternal societies and lodge practices. David Beto pointed out in From Mutual Aid to the Welfare State, Fraternal Societies and Social Services, the leading beneficiary of lodge practice was, of course, the patient of modest means. He or she was able to obtain physician's care for about $2 a year, roughly the equivalent to a day's wage for a laborer. For comparable amounts, some lodges extended coverage to family members. The local medical society in Meadville, Pennsylvania, was typical in setting the following minimum fees for its members. $1 per physical examination, surgical dressing, and daytime house call, and $2 per nighttime house call. Such charges, at least for ongoing service, were beyond the reach of many lower-income Americans. Hence, it was not coincidental, an editorial in the Medical Council pointed out, that lodge practice thrived in communities populated by the working poor. This free market and mutual aid healthcare system greatly benefited the poor and provided quality and accessible healthcare. And like I said earlier, these prices were mostly driven by competition. According to an article from American Economic Education, prices for hospital services like knee replacement or MRI are on average 15% higher in monopoly markets than in more competitive regions with at least four hospitals. A paper from the National Bureau of Economic Research by David R. Francis pointed out it was approximately 8% more costly to be treated in the least competitive fourth of hospital markets, and the quality of care in competitive markets was higher as well. This once again disproves Cenk's Nephew's entire argument on inelastic demand. If you want a modern example of free market healthcare, then you might want to check out Dr. Keith Smith of the Surgery Center of Oklahoma. He is also the founder of the Free Market Medical Association. Dr. Smith has never taken a single penny of government money. He gives patients quotes on what their care will cost, and they pay him directly. It's a single payer system, but the single payer is the patient. Medical care at the Surgery Center of Oklahoma is generally 90% cheaper than the national average. There's even been cases of patients in other states like Georgia receiving high quotes from local hospitals and practices. They then get quotes from Dr. Keith Smith, which are significantly lower, and tell the local hospitals or private practices that they are going to go there instead. At that point, some of the locals actually offer to do the same services at the same cost as the Surgery Center of Oklahoma. This has saved patients thousands and thousands of dollars. We need a lot more places like the Surgery Center of Oklahoma.
More examples of restricted competition leading to higher prices is drug patents. We should not have drug patents.
Wait, okay, I agree with this one. So, respect.
Especially on necessary and life-saving drugs. There is no reason that you should have a monopoly on a life-saving drug.
Wait a minute, but like, that's the only reason why people, the only reason why people do innovative things is because, you know, they want to fucking maintain their patent and, you know, it's their profits to have. Like, this contradicts his entire worldview on anything else, by the way.
Remember before when I said that me being against certificate of need laws were the only reason Cenk's Nephew was willing to defend them? Well, now he's hit a wall because there's no possible way he can defend drug patents. So this time, instead of defending them, he decides to claim that I am actually secretly for them. Wow, okay. No, I have been against drug patents for as long as I've known what they are. I'm also against intellectual property, and anarcho-capitalists in general are against intellectual property, and especially drug patents. Property is a scarce resource that you have final control over. An idea is not a scarce resource. If I restrict other people from using my idea or an idea similar to it, all I'm doing is saying what they can and cannot do with their own property. So of course I'm against this. Anyways, that's it for today's video. Thank you everyone for watching. Next week's video is going to be about John Doyle, so you're definitely gonna wanna watch that one. So I will see you guys next time.